Boris FX Optics allows you several different ways that you can limit effects to a region of your image. One of the most powerful happens to be selective masks, which taps into the color information of your photo and is also the gateway to luminance masking. In this video, I'll walk you through that workflow and how you can combine selective masks with additional masking tools so you isolate things exactly where you need them to be. Let's get started. Okay, I'm here inside of Photoshop with an image shot by Renee Robin that I've turned into a smart layer. I'm gonna send this over to Optics by going to the filter menu, where we'll choose Boris FX Optics. When starting fresh on a photo, we do not need to apply previous filters and masks as shown in the dialog box. Let me press no. What we'd like to do is add a moon to the brightest pixels here in the sky. We'll accomplish this in the layers panel by working with the current selected layer. At the top of the panel, click on the add mask icon and let's choose selection. Immediately, a few things happen. One is that we see a small thumbnail identifying the current pixels selected, which corresponds with the information at the top of the menu. And it's currently set to luminance. Right now, it's selecting the brightest pixels in the sky. Now we can choose what color or luminance values are currently be selected from this long list. But for now, we'll stick with luminance. And also note that this thumbnail is a bit too small. In the viewer, I'll click on the show mask icon so we have a nice big view of the pixels selected. The position value, which is currently set to 100, is now maxed out with the highest luminant values. If we were looking for something a little bit more in the midtones of our image or the shadows, we would simply drag down this position value. And if I drag it down to 5, I'm targeting more shadows. We can also see this clearer by doing an A-B comparison, where I now can compare the mask to the original image and seeing those dark pixels. Another thing to keep in mind is the range value right next to position. Pixels that are within close range to that position value of 6 are also selected. If we tighten up the range, less pixels close to that value are selected. If we increase it, more are. I'm just going to reset the range value, not to mention the position value to 100%, and now start to target the range to be just those brighter pixels in the sky. Two additional values that we can get into the mix happen to be the black clip and the white clip, where I can introduce more bright pixels here in the selected region of the sky. Notice how the black and white clip icons refer to each end of the range. Now that we have the selection that we want out of the A-B comparison and turn off the show mask or press the M key, and let's head to the render category where we'll go to S Luna to apply a moon and make sure it's a full moon. I'll head to the parameters tab here on the right and start to play with its position, not to mention its scale. And we can see there with that luminance mask applied, our moon is behind our subject and limited to those bright regions of the sky. I'm gonna go back and play with that white clip value, bringing it back down so it appears a bit more behind the clouds. Now the best part is, now that we have a luminance mask, we can reuse this information on our layer and new layers that we create. In the layers panel, I'm gonna head to our S Luna or our current layer, click on the arrow next to the picture icon and duplicate that layer. I have now a duplicate layer that transfers not only the effect, but also then the mask that we currently have. In order to focus our attention on the top layer, I'll head to the middle layer and click on the lightning bolt icon in order to not see the moon shining through when we make adjustments. Let's head to Film Lab and go to S Film Effect and look over to the lower left-hand side where you'll find our presets, where we'll select the red contrast filter. And notice that it appears in the exact same region of the sky as S underscore Luna. Now let's hop back into mask mode by pressing M, and on our top layer, select the mask so that we see the toolbar appear here at the top. Instead of having it appear in the sky, we do want to have it appear on the steps here at the bottom, which we can look at also with our A-B comparison. I will scrub the position value to now select more pixels within that stair case. And I'll also try to play with the range a bit to see if I can get more pixels selected here in the stairs, noticing that it also selects pixels in unwanted areas. This is where we can combine this with an additional mask so that it's limited exactly where we want it to be. In our layers panel, let's click on the Add Mask button and choose the path mask, which is going to be added after our current Luma mask on the top layer. I'll hop out of the A-B comparison and also press M to toggle off mask mode. I'd like to draw a path that does not include our main subject and only the stairs. In order to get precise, I'll click on 100% to completely zoom into the image. And if that was too close, we could always use a specific zoom level by clicking on these arrows or typing in the calculator. I'll press the space bar in order to pan across this image. I'll click here to make a new point, and a path will be created. And we can continue to click to make additional path points around our subject. The best part is we can also change the type of path this is by selecting a point or multiple points and choosing from this list of options depending on your preferred workflow. I'll zoom out a little bit and continue until I have my desired selection. Now, once we get close to the first point, we're just going to click on it in order to close out the shape. Now, you may notice that although that we added that additional mask, it's still not limited to that region that we specified. And this has everything to do with mask modes. Here, with the new mask applied, I can see currently it's set to a normal mode. We have an option to have this subtracted from the list, which would then just have the red contrast effect outside of this specified area. Or alternatively, we can have it multiply and mix in with our previous mask, which is exactly what we want in this case. I can see now that that red contrast film effect is isolated to the stairs, and I can press 0 in order to toggle off that path overlay. The best part is if we feel this effect is too strong, we can combine these masks also with the opacity level of our layer or mix it in with a specific blend mode. In this instance, I'll keep that red contrast effect at 60%. We could also make additional changes to the path mask that we selected, including blurring out our given path selection. At any point in time, we can copy all of our masks for continued work by simply clicking the Export Mask button next to a given layer. And now let's see this new selection, where I'll now go back to the original Luma Mask layer and turn that on, where our moon is isolated to the sky and this lovely red contrast ground isolated to the stairs. And that is how we can get the most out of selective masks inside of Boris FX Optics. For more tips and tricks on optics and other masking workflows, don't forget to check out borisfx.com. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you around our channel sometime soon.